Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Marsh Builders, The Fight for Clean Water, Wetlands, and Wildlife by Sharon Levy. Narrated by Karen White. Introduction. The hunter's eye holds a look of obsessed concentration. Ankle deep in water, the great blue heron waits for its prey. Imitate. Stand still, keep silent, watch. The bird's head shoots forward on its long neck, moving so fast the details of the action cannot be comprehended by human sight. A splash. Now the heron grasps a struggling fish crossways in its bill. The victim's tail fin twitches. The fish translates into a silver flash, falling into the bird's gullet. A brief, digestive pause. Then the heron launches into the air, tucking its lanky legs up against its body, folding its neck into a compact S-curve. At the Arcata Marsh and Wildlife Sanctuary, a few blocks from downtown Arcata, on California's north coast, it's easy to stumble into scenes like this one. I first explored the place as a wildlife fanatic. River otters played together, gliding across the water, diving without a splash. Thousands of sandpipers burst into a whirl of coordinated flight, startled by the passage of a hunting peregrine falcon. A short-eared owl cruised over the reeds at dusk, listening for the telltale splash of a frog moving in the shallows. This habitat, crowded with birds, hikers, and picnickers, is fueled by sewage. In the 1970s, a handful of activists in this town on the shore of Humboldt Bay fought a years-long political battle with state officials. They rejected the state's plan for an expensive, energy-intensive regional sewage system. In the process, they stumbled on the idea of using wetlands to filter pollutants out of their wastewater. It's a notion so simple and so effective that it has since been adapted at tens of thousands of constructed wetland projects worldwide. The marsh is a place of paradoxes, a wildlife sanctuary awash in sewage, a habitat that exists because environmentalists fought state officials enforcing the Clean Water Act. It's one of my favorite places to walk, to look at life, to ponder. It's also become a door, a portal into the past and potential future of our relationship to wetlands and to water itself. We need constructed wetlands like Arcata's because humanity has a penchant for destroying natural ones. The Earth has seen the loss of more than 64% of its native wetlands since 1900. In major agricultural states like California, Ohio, and Iowa, the figure is closer to 90%. Swamps and marshes have been drained to create farmland and destroy mosquito habitat. They've been paved over with concrete, replaced by shopping malls and suburban neighborhoods, their disappearance considered a victory. Wetlands develop at the edges between earth and water, at the shallow margins of bays, lakes, ponds, and rivers. Their plants, adapted to soggy conditions, grow with their roots underwater. A swamp is dominated by trees. A marsh grows rushes, sedges, wildflowers. Wetlands capture pollutants, absorb rising waters in times of flooding, stabilize shorelines, act as an important sink for carbon in the era of global warming, and serve as a crucial wildlife habitat. Conservationists first began to advocate for wetland protection when populations of North American waterfowl began to plummet early in the 20th century. Migratory ducks need wetlands to shelter and feed them during their long journeys to and from their breeding grounds. Human welfare, it turns out, is also tied to the boggy landscapes we had long condemned as wastelands and sources of disease. It just took a long time for us to notice. While humanity was busy making wetlands disappear, a major undertaking from the mid-19th century onwards, we were adding mass doses of sewage to the waterways that sustain us. The evolution of sewage reveals urban Homo sapiens bumbling along in a struggle to evade the stink and disease carried in its own wastes. Along the way came flashes of brilliance. Observers in Europe and the U.S. began to realize that benign bacteria can break down the pollutants in sewage, and that these microbes can be harnessed to treat our endless flow of fouled water. The basics of conventional wastewater treatment were worked out at the turn of the 20th century, but would not be widely used until the 1970s, when an army of citizen activists began to fight for clean water. At the same moment, a handful of ecologists began to recognize the ability of wetlands to capture and break down pollutants. This startling revelation hit scientists working in Germany, the Netherlands, North Carolina, Massachusetts, and Florida. The habitats we had forced out of the landscape were revealed as key to controlling the overload of waste and nutrients flowing out of cities, industries, and farm fields. In 1974, two newly elected members of Arcata's city council began to resist the state's plan for a regional system that would have ringed Humboldt Bay with miles of sewer lines. They didn't know much about wetlands, but they could see that the project, as proposed, would be the biggest energy consumer in Humboldt County, that it would spend millions of dollars to pump sewage across long distances, that it would lead to urban sprawl. Those were the reasons they started to fight. Arcata's sewage resistors stumbled onto the low-cost, environmentally friendly concept of wetland treatment, propelled by political pressures. In a way, they were like William Dibdin, the 19th-century London bureaucrat. To save the City of London money, he'd set out to argue that its deluge of raw sewage did not harm the Thames River. He ended up showing, through careful observation and experimentation, that managed communities of microbes could cleanse sewage before it reached the river. Those same microbes are at work in every healthy wetland. Arcata's activists of the 1970s set out to stop a big steel and concrete sewage project and ended up building a wetland that has become the city's most beloved park. Tens of thousands of people hike there every year, and most of them have no clue that they're walking through part of a wastewater treatment plant. They're too busy watching the birds to notice. Many long-distance migrants find shelter among the reeds. 334 species of birds have been sighted at the marsh. Beneath its calm surface, Arcata's marsh holds lessons on the intertwined histories of wetlands and water pollution. More than 150 years after the first sewage treatment techniques were invented, it has become clear that conventional systems won't be enough to keep our lakes and bays healthy or our drinking water safe. We have transformed whole landscapes to sustain our way of living, fouling vast watersheds in the process. Solving the problem will take many kinds of change. Wetlands, great and small, will be part of the answer. 1. Cholera's Frontiers. Sewage as we know it, the everyday miracle of feces disappearing down the toilet, pushed by a never-ending flow of clean water, is a recent invention. The flush toilet itself has been created and then forgotten many times down through the ages. But the grand scheme that we all take for granted, an endless supply of clean water piped in and limitless amounts of dirty water piped out, was thought up by Edwin Chadwick, a British lawyer turned public health crusader, in the 1840s. Back then, the cities of the old world were awash in human waste. Even the most elegant homes had privies that emptied into cesspits, where decades of accumulated filth sat rotting beneath the parlor floor. The poor lived in tenements where dozens of people might have to share one privy. Chadwick supervised a survey of sanitary conditions in English cities that came up with some amazing statistics. In parts of Manchester, there was one privy to every 215 people. Some houses had yards covered 6 inches deep in human ordure, which the inhabitants crossed by stepping on bricks. Sir Henry de la Beche was obliged at Bristol to stand up at the end of alleys and vomit, while Dr. Playfair was investigating overflowing privies. Chadwick wrote of one of his colleagues, "Sir Henry was obliged to give it up." London had sewers, of a sort. They were open ditches that sloped toward the Thames and were meant to drain stormwater out of the streets. But by Chadwick's day, the gunk from thousands of overflowing cesspits emptied into these sewers, then oozed its way into the river. Parliament's windows on the riverfront had not been opened in years because of the stench. The Chelsea Water Company, which provided drinking water to many Londoners, still had its intake a few feet from the outfall of the Ranelagh sewer. An editorial in The Spectator pointed out that city residents paid the water companies £340,000 per annum for a more or less concentrated solution of native guano. Chadwick's sanitary report of 1842 carefully documented the correlation between bad sanitation and high death rates. Today, this idea seems painfully obvious, but in the mid-19th century, no one understood why filth could kill. An eccentric Dutch shopkeeper named Anton van Leeuwenhoek had built the first microscope more than 100 years earlier and found that his water cistern, his skin, and the inside of his mouth were all swarming with live creatures, too tiny to see with the naked eye. Microbes were known to exist, but most scientists remained unimpressed. No one had made the connection between von Leeuwenhoek's discovery and infectious diseases. Despite repeated epidemics of cholera, typhoid, and yellow fever, many prominent doctors did not believe that diseases could be contagious at all. The medical wisdom of the time held that disease was caused by chemical substances from decaying filth. Breathing in these miasmas could cause deadly illness. All smell is, if it be intense, immediate acute disease, wrote Chadwick. And eventually we may say that by depressing the system and rendering it susceptible to the action of other causes, all smell is disease. Chadwick had a vision of how he would deodorize England's cities. It depended on channeling great volumes of clean water into every neighborhood, then flushing it away once it was dirty. This would mean a restructured water supply system. No one had indoor plumbing in those days. Instead, people paid water companies for limited access to a well or for delivered water. Chadwick foresaw a newfangled water closet in every household. Complex new sewer projects would have to be built. Instead of the old rectangular ditches that drained London, he planned to build underground pipes, rounded and tapering at the bottom, so that the sewage would flow fast and carry its smelly load off efficiently into the nearest river. He recognized his scheme's drawback. It would pollute rivers all over the country. He hoped to solve this by diverting sewage to farm fields, where it could be used as liquid manure. But his first priority was to get the waste out of town as soon as possible, no matter where it went. He believed this would save thousands of lives. Chadwick's sanitary idea, that water and sewers should be provided by one centralized authority, run by himself, remained a political football for 7 years. The companies that had a long-standing monopoly on urban water supplies opposed him. So did local officials, who resented Chadwick moving in on their turf. In 1848, Chadwick landed the position of Sanitary Commissioner of London. As he campaigned to win the appointment, cholera was sweeping through Europe and into England. People who appeared healthy would suddenly collapse, going cold in the limbs and blue in the face. Many died within hours of becoming ill. The epidemic reached London in February 1849. 14,000 Londoners would die before the outbreak subsided. Chadwick unknowingly helped kill many of them. He ordered the city's antique sewers to be flushed as never before. Better to pollute the river, he believed, than to leave the stuff in the sewers where it would give off fetid exhalations. Cholera bacteria are passed in human waste, and heavy loads were washed into the Thames, the only water source for thousands of people. As the epidemic raged in August 1849, 5,773 cubic yards of filth were being flushed from the sewers into the river each week, under Chadwick's enthusiastic direction. The monthly death rate shot up from 246 in June to 1,952 in July and 4,251 in August, peaking at 6,644 in September. It was the first of many such public health disasters. No one had found a good way to deal with the resulting sewage, but the idea of household taps and the flush toilet gained in popularity. By the 1880s, American cities like Boston and Newark were sewering up, flushing their untreated waste into the nearest river. In towns downstream, death rates from cholera, typhoid, and other waterborne diseases soared. Chadwick, an arrogant, prickly character, made many political enemies. He might never have achieved enough power and influence to change London's sewer system if cholera had not made people desperate. Cholera gave Chadwick followers who would transform the urban landscapes of Europe and America forever. Their passion for better sewers would begin to save lives in the largest, most crowded urban centers, while they intensified the fouling of waters downstream. Cholera and water pollution are bound together in a complex evolutionary knot. Each has helped to create the other. The dread disease that has swept every inhabited continent during the past 200 years and still sickens millions and kills thousands in the developing world, is a new variation on an ancient bacterial theme. And it flourishes in nutrient-rich water, especially when that water is contaminated with human waste. Robert Koch, one of the founding fathers of microbiology, first isolated the cholera bacterium in Egypt in 1883. Viewed through a microscope, the tiny culprit he'd extracted from the intestines of cholera patients looked like a comma. Koch called it the comma bacillus and noted that it could also be found clinging to aquatic plants in polluted waters. Later, other scientists would name the germ Vibrio cholerae. The mystery of cholera wasn't solved with the identification of Vibrio, however. New questions kept cropping up. One of the most urgent concerned where V. cholerae hid out between its intermittent crime sprees. Cholera is an ancient illness. An outbreak with symptoms typical of cholera is described in 2,500-year-old Sanskrit writings. The disease is endemic in the Ganges River Delta and along the coast of the Bay of Bengal, where outbreaks occur predictably every spring and fall. In 1817, the first episode of pandemic cholera spread from the Ganges Delta near Calcutta, India, into the Middle East, Europe, and East Africa, killing hundreds of thousands. The outbreak subsided for a few years, then flared again in 1829. Over the next two decades, epidemic cholera struck around the world, following the routes of human travel. It reached England in 1831 with sailors who came to port in Sunderland. In the late 1840s, while Chadwick was campaigning to flush more sewage into the Thames, V. cholerae reached America. The disease arrived at the port of New York and headed west in the distressed innards of ambitious pioneers. The second pandemic subsided in 1850, but cholera has swept around the globe five more times since then, gradually evolving new variations. The most recent pandemic, which has spread to South America and Haiti, began in 1961 and continues today, having affected more than 7 million people. It involves a new strain of cholera bacteria that was first identified in 1992. Between outbreaks, cholera may vanish from human populations for several years or decades at a time. Researchers searched for a hidden reservoir of cholera, a sign that people or their animals could carry the infection without showing overt symptoms. Then, in the 1980s, a team led by Rita Colwell of the University of Maryland found V. cholerae alive and well in the waters of both the Chesapeake Bay and the Bay of Bengal, clinging to the shells of copepods, minuscule crustaceans that drift with the currents. The cholera bacterium and its close cousins, also members of the genus Vibrio, live in estuaries all around the planet. Many types of Vibrio survive in even the cleanest of tidewaters, and most have nothing to do with people, growing only among the plankton, clams, and fish. The hunt for the wild Vibrio took so long because in hungry times, when the waters it lives in are not overloaded with nutrients from sewage or stormwater runoff, V. cholerae stops reproducing and goes into a dormant form. The bacteria can live for a long time this way, waiting for the opportune moment, the right combination of temperature, salinity, and nutrient load that will signal the time to wake up and procreate. When microbiologists looked for Vibrios using the traditional technique of culturing germs from water samples, these dormant Vibrios didn't grow, and so they remained invisible. Colwell and her colleagues uncovered dormant Vibrios using a new tool. They exposed mice to V. cholerae so that the mice produced antibodies that would latch onto cholera bacteria and nothing else. Then they attached a fluorescent molecule to the antibodies, turning them into microscopic signal beacons. When these fluorescent antibodies were added to samples of estuary water, they showed that V. cholerae were not only present, but abundant. Most of the germs clung to the shells of planktonic creatures, especially the copepods, which look like a miniaturized cross between a lobster and a beetle. In photomicrographs of these water samples, glowing microbes outline the shapes of the copepods, like constellations in a night sky. Many disease-causing microbes need people to survive, but Vibrios do not. They are everyday citizens of normal estuaries, at home attached to plankton and aquatic plants. The bacteria nourish themselves off the chitin in copepod shells. They have a special enzyme designed to digest it. V. cholerae is tightly linked to copepods, so much so that filtering contaminated water through folded sari cloth, which forms a mesh fine enough to capture copepods, removes more than 90% of V. cholerae cells as well. 5 years after Colwell and her colleagues taught this simple technique to women in MATLAB, Bangladesh, cholera infection rates there were halved. When untreated sewage enters the equation, algae, copepods, and Vibrios all turn opportunist. Sewage is rich in nutrients, a jolt of liquid fertilizer. Algae absorb it and reproduce like mad. Copepods, which feed on algae, also boom. A polluted estuary is a Vibrio paradise, pleasantly brackish and full of abundant food and handy plankton to rest on. When a lot of people are crowded together at the edge of an estuary without a good sanitation system, their waste fuels an explosion of the Vibrio population. Along the Bengal coast, the disease strikes twice a year, under conditions that can be traced to the abundance of copepods in drinking water. In the spring, low river flows allow plankton-rich bay water to intrude into the ponds used by local people as water sources. In the fall, monsoon rains swell the rivers, flushing nutrients from the land into the delta and bay. Plankton bloom in the fertilized waters, carrying abundant V. cholerae across the flooded landscape. Both drought and monsoons are predicted to intensify as the climate continues to warm. Warm water plankton species are moving toward the poles as ocean temperatures rise. Man-made climate change now threatens to intensify the risk of cholera epidemics. Yet, of the diverse strains of V. cholerae that can be found in the wild, most are not dangerous to humans. To become successful pathogens, strains of V. cholerae must acquire a set of genetic traits that allow them to thrive in the human gut and to spread from one infected victim to another. Among the critical traits are the genes that code for cholera toxin, a protein that wreaks havoc with the salt balance of cells lining the small intestine. The toxin causes cells to pump electrolytes and water into the lumen of the intestine, causing the severe diarrhea and dehydration characteristic of cholera. One result is that the infected person's gut is awash in nutrient-rich, salty fluid, an ideal growth medium for the cholera bacterium. Pathogenic V. cholerae bacteria also produce pili, long filamentous extensions that enable them to attach to the gut lining. The genes that code for pili production act in concert with those that produce cholera toxin. So, among cholera researchers, these attachment factors are known as toxin-co-regulated pili, TCP. The genetic code for cholera toxin comes from a bacteriophage, a virus that infects some strains of V. cholerae. TCP act as a receptor for attachment and infection by the bacteriophage. These relationships suggest that the human gut, the only place where pili are expressed, is the site where V. cholerae strains acquire their pathogenic traits. A recent study tracks the evolution of the L. tor strain of V. cholerae, the cause of the seventh ongoing global cholera pandemic. The L. tor strain occupied human guts as early as the 1890s, though at that early stage it did not make people sick. By the 1930s, L. tor was causing isolated outbreaks in which victims suffered symptoms of classic cholera, but the strain was not yet highly contagious, and the outbreaks subsided. It took decades for this line of V. cholerae to pick up the traits that made it into a lethal threat. The first outbreaks of the seventh pandemic occurred in 1961 near the town of Makassar in Sulawesi, Indonesia. The responsible strain had originated decades earlier in the coastal waters of Bengal, and it acquired more and more pathogenic traits as it traveled in human bodies along an ancient migratory pathway that led first to the Middle East and then to Indonesia. In 2010, the L. tor strain made the leap across oceans to Haiti, where it triggered an intense outbreak of cholera. "The disease struck with explosive force," said reporter Richard Knox. "Within 2 days of the first cases, A hospital 60 miles away was admitting a new cholera patient every 3.5 minutes. Cholera has since killed thousands in Haiti and is now endemic there as it is in its ancient homeland of Bangladesh. Genomic sequencing of the V. cholerae strain involved showed that the disease had traveled to the island in the guts of Nepalese peacekeepers sent by the UN to aid in Haiti's reconstruction following a major earthquake, and had been released into streams and rivers because of improper sewage disposal at the UN camp near the town of Mirbalay. Throughout its history, cholera has flared up from polluted waters to travel across oceans and continents inside human hosts. In 1867 and again in 1891, cholera struck a large gathering of people who came to the shores of the Bay of Bengal for the Hardawar Fair, and many of the survivors carried the germ back to their hometowns. Several times in the mid-19th century, cholera swept through the thousands of Muslims gathered for the annual pilgrimage to Mecca, and again, the people carried pathogenic vibrios back to their homes. America's pilgrimage in those times was west to the California Gold Rush. People from all over the U.S. dropped everything and followed the immigrant trail. Among them was an opinionated doctor named Israel Shipman Pelton Lord. The journal he wrote during his travels is very much a tale of cholera. Lord lived in Illinois. He'd only gotten as far west as Missouri when, in May 1849, he began to meet victims of the disease. "We left a dead man by the name of Middleton on the levee at St. Louis and thought that we had left all the cholera with him," Lord wrote. "We were grievously disappointed, however." Along the Missouri River, he watched some of his fellow steamboat passengers die off and passed towns that had been emptied by the scourge. Later, as he moved through Kansas and Nebraska, he found cholera victims lying exhausted and alone at the trail's edge. By September 1850, Lord had tried his hand at gold mining in California and given it up in disgust. He was living in Sacramento, a hectic, filthy boomtown near the spot where gold had first been discovered. The previous spring, the town had been home to 150 people. The Sacramento Lord knew that fall held 6,000, and what primitive sanitation there may have been could not keep pace with the population explosion. When the Sacramento River flooded during the boom years, and it often did, it spread waterborne diseases everywhere. Eventually, the settlers would raise the street level by 12 feet in an effort to escape their own sewage. "The cholera is approaching us slowly from both east and west," Lord wrote on September 30, 1849. "It will make a charnel house of Sacramento when it comes." He was soon run ragged trying to attend to cholera victims and recorded as many as 40 deaths in a single day. His diary entries include long, angry harangues against doctors who dosed cholera patients with laudanum, which he believed did more harm than good. On November 3rd, his only diary entry was terse. "Sick today. Cholera symptoms. Weather the same." Lord survived. By late November, when the disease had run its course in Sacramento, he estimated that 3/4 of the city's population had died. In December 1849, Israel Lord suffered through a flood on the polluted Sacramento River. The stink of the sewage-enriched Thames choked London, and Josiah Gregg stood knee-deep in a pristine stream just north of Humboldt Bay. He was cursing like a lunatic. In a few years, this river, named the Mad in honor of Gregg's fit of temper, would form Arcata's northern boundary, and farms would cover the lowlands along its banks. Greg led a band of 8 ragged men who came west from their gold mines on the Trinity River, staggered for weeks over snow-covered mountains and through a maze of giant redwoods, and arrived on the shore of the Pacific just north of Arcata. They were starving, cold, and extremely irritable, and they were about to go down in history as the first white men to discover Humboldt Bay by land. An adventurer and scholar who had written a popular book about his travels on the Great Plains, Greg had an obsession for scientific measurement. This, along with the severe trials of the journey, was driving the men with him crazy. While they were recovering from some nervous encounter with a band of Indians who had never met white people before, or fainting with hunger after 2 days without food, Greg would insist on stopping to measure a redwood or to read their latitude. By the time they reached the Mad River, they had no patience left for Greg. When he stopped to read the latitude at the mouth of the river, they cursed him soundly. Lewis K. Wood, who survived the expedition to become one of Arcata's founding citizens, remembered that this was not at all unusual, and threatened to launch their canoes without him, leaving Greg stranded. He had to wade into the water to catch the canoes, and on the other bank, he exploded in rage. Greg had spent most of his life following the frontier west, beyond the civilized boundaries of the U.S. "I could never live under my oppression of spirits anywhere in the U.S., where I would be liable to continued annoyance," he once wrote to his brother. But he ended his life by opening up the last untamed corner of California to settlement. He died trying to make his way back out of the redwood wilderness and was buried near Clear Lake, about halfway between Humboldt Bay and San Francisco. His companions claimed that starvation killed him, but some historians speculate that they murdered him out of sheer aggravation. Either way, Wood and the other members of the expedition did make it back to San Francisco, and they brought word of what they'd found: a bay surrounded by fertile lowlands, a nice spot where a man could farm, if he was not too busy getting rich by running supplies to the gold mines on the Klamath and Trinity Rivers. Civilization came to Humboldt Bay in a rush. By 1850, Arcata's town square had sprung up on a small prairie overlooking the bay, where the Greg expedition had spent Christmas Eve in 1849. Within a few years, stores and saloons lined the edge of the plaza, and more than 500 people lived in town. The scale of the place was still small enough that people could get along fine with an outhouse in the backyard. Nobody had indoor plumbing. When folks needed water, they carried buckets past the cows grazing in the middle of town and pumped at the well that had been sunk at the center of the plaza. No one worried about piping in water until 1875, when a fire in Alexander Brizard's store raged out of control and destroyed most of the businesses on the plaza. The town board of trustees decided Arcata needed water mains, the first ingredient for a functioning fire department. After years of dithering, the water system was finally completed in 1884. Pipes, made of hollowed-out redwood logs laid end to end, carried water from holding tanks on the hill above town down to 4 fire hydrants on the plaza. The water supply wasn't just used for the fire hydrants, of course. The town's wealthier families were building elegant homes for themselves, and they wanted running water on tap. They also began to order water closets, ornate porcelain fixtures that came up from San Francisco by ship. The flush toilet hit the big time in the 1880s. By the end of the decade, few people would consider building a house without one. In Arcata, as in cities all over the U.S., people started to build sewers as an afterthought when they realized they needed somewhere for the stuff coming out of their toilets to go. The town's first sewer line ran down from the big Victorian houses on the hill, past the new brick store that was Alexander Brizard's pride. It went down to the edge of the bay, where the raw sewage came gurgling out. 2. Tides of Change. When Dan Hauser and his friend Wesley Chesbro won the Arcata City Council race, their opponents did not concede gracefully. "I'm not a poor loser," claimed Clyde Johnson, just before he called Hauser and Chesbro orangutans. Then Johnson and the other disappointed candidates accused the winners of using dirty campaign tricks, just like President Nixon. Arcata's weekly paper, The Union, ran the details of the post-election flap on its front page. That March of 1974, the national obsession with the Watergate scandal reached its peak. The president's closest aides were on trial for burglary, wiretapping, and obstruction of justice. Nixon had become an international symbol of corruption, and the polls showed his public approval rating plummeting to an all-time low. So while Hauser and Chesbro could laugh off the comparison to an ape, when they were likened to the president, the insult cut deep. It was a rough time to start a political career, especially in Arcata, an old logging town on the shores of Humboldt Bay in California's damp northwest corner. The community was splitting in two like a redwood slat struck with an axe. On one side stood ranchers and timber workers, many of them descendants of the first pioneers to settle here in the 1850s. On the other were outsiders like Hauser and Chesbro, people who'd recently migrated to town to study or teach at Humboldt State University, HSU, and who'd decided to stay in this foggy enclave, 250 miles north of San Francisco. Now, for the first time, the outsiders controlled the city council. The old-time Arcadians felt like victims of an alien invasion. That feeling intensified when the national fad for high-speed nudity reached HSU. A few days after the election, four young guys ran naked through the university quad. Behind them, the crowns of the redwood trees at the edge of campus vanished into the fog. A cold rain fell as the earnest exhibitionists moved across the lawn, and goosebumps rose all over their bodies. They were members of the Streakers for Impeachment Committee, a national organization dedicated to streaking for the ouster of President Nixon. Dan Hauser was a mild-mannered insurance adjuster and liberal Democrat, caught in the clash between the buck-naked protesters on campus and traditional Arcata families. The accusations of Watergate-style dirty tricks against him and Chesbro were wildly overblown. The losers were reacting to a skit broadcast on the university radio station just before the election. It mocked all the contenders, but was kind to Hauser and Chesbro. The broadcast, the defeated candidates complained, crossed the lines of fair play and good taste. Hauser had known nothing about the radio sketch until after it was aired. He had spent the campaign walking all over town, knocking on doors, and explaining his stand on land use planning to anyone who would listen. On days when he couldn't summon up the will to go out and campaign, his 11-year-old daughter gave him a pep talk and went along with him. 2 months before the 1974 election, the Brizard Matthews Machinery Company, owned by two longtime Humboldt County families, bought a full-page ad in the Union. They used the space for a political call to arms. Their ad accused environmentalists of wrecking the local economy by fighting to put more forests in national parks and of raising food prices by working to ban DDT and other necessary pesticides. It urged readers to get out and vote against people like Hauser and Chesbro. The two new council members disagreed with Arcata's conservatives on everything from the Vietnam War to forestry reform. They won the election with the help of a strong voter turnout from HSU students, who'd never wielded much influence in town before. But after a change in federal law granted 18-year-olds the right to vote in 1972, Arcata politics would never be the same. The old Arcata stalwarts knew it, too. The night before the council election, Hauser and Chesbro walked up to campus to post their campaign literature. Everywhere they went, they found the walls already covered with flyers that urged the students not to vote. "This isn't your community," the flyers read. "You shouldn't determine the city's government." The don't vote propaganda was Lois Arkley's idea. Lois, the daughter of Robert Matthews of Brizard Matthews, worked the campus that evening with her husband, Robin, a conservative mill owner and rancher. The Arkleys stood united in their loathing of the political changes they saw coming. "Chesbro was born for us to hate," recalls Robin Arkley. "Here was this hippie kid with long hair and a scraggly beard who was going to be running our town. We felt we were being totally disenfranchised." "My first reaction was to tear those posters down," says Hauser. "But Wesley, being more politically astute than I was, said we should leave them up because it would make the students mad enough to get out and vote. And in the end, it did have that reaction. So we followed along behind the Arkleys, and we put our posters up next to theirs." Hauser is a tall, soft-spoken man, a shy person whose stomach used to clench when he had to speak in public. It took a lot of Rolaids to get him through the city council campaign. In 1974, he'd been married for 10 years to his high school sweetheart, Donna, and they had two young kids. When he was growing up in Southern California, Hauser watched urban sprawl devour the farmland around his home in Orange County. By 1961, when he started college, the truck gardens and orange groves he'd loved as a kid were wiped out. "Traffic was becoming impossible," he says, "and it was not where I wanted to raise a family." He discovered Humboldt County during a fishing trip with his dad, and 2 years later, he and his new wife moved north. His campaign for city council focused on resisting uncontrolled development. Arcata was still surrounded by second-growth forests and pastures dotted with dairy cows. 7 miles of farm fields stretched along the edge of the bay between Arcata and Eureka, the nearest city to the south, and Hauser wanted to keep them open. If you pulled off Highway 101 and spent a few minutes in those fields, you'd see much more than cows. A red-shouldered hawk would pass overhead, then a great egret, 3 feet tall and draped in startling white plumes, would stalk by. The big birds liked to loiter in pastures where they found easy prey. Field mice gave themselves away when they ran from the crushing hooves of the cattle. Hauser knew that developers were eager to change this bucolic scene. The city of Eureka had recently tried to annex a large chunk of farmland, hoping to pave the way for a series of fast food places, motels, and shopping centers. The tide that had washed away rural Orange County waited to sweep into Humboldt. He had campaigned against a big development that the Fords, an old-time Humboldt County ranching and logging family, planned to build south of Arcata. "It was the wrong development in the wrong place," he says. "I'd done my homework. The Bay Muds would not support the kinds of structures they wanted to build at that location." There was no sewer system there either, so the waste from the apartment complex and shopping center the Fords envisioned would have nowhere to go. Ultimately, Hauser's efforts defeated the development, but they also earned him some dedicated enemies. A group of longtime Arcatans formed an organization they called Arcata Forever, and proceeded to spend the next few years making life difficult for Hauser and Chesbro. They saw us as somewhere very far to the left of Joseph Stalin, says Hauser. We were anti-Vietnam War, so we were therefore anti-patriotic. By the time of his first city council meeting, Hauser had seen enough to know that his critics would be loud and uninhibited, but he thought he knew what to expect. My issues were land use planning and historic preservation, he says. I knew some of that would be controversial, but I thought the majority of the people would support it. He knew nothing about the regional sewage project that appeared on the agenda at that first meeting. He didn't know that he'd spend the next 6 years fighting against the big sewage plant, while every authority figure in sight assured him his cause was hopeless. We'd had no preparation for this issue, and Wesley and I balked. Things were going over our heads, says Hauser. At the end of the meeting, a friend came up to me and just blasted me for not taking a strong stand. I said, I don't even know what they're talking about. In all the technical documents that had been thrown at him, one thing caught Hauser's eye. It was a diagram that showed a sewer line running from Arcata south to Eureka along Highway 101, at the edge of the pasture land he'd been trying to protect. If that sewer line was ever built, the cow pastures would be turned into a developer's field of dreams. Anyone who paid attention knew that if you built sewers, they'd come. Humboldt Bay was in trouble. That much was undeniable. A 1973 survey found 63 different pipes oozing mysterious fluids into the water, sources unknown. The city of Eureka had 3 separate sewage treatment plants, none of which worked reliably or reached modern standards. In the hard rains of winter, treatment capacity was overloaded, and raw wastewater flowed into the bay. The creeks rose, carrying loads of silt and manure downstream from the dairy pastures. Humboldt County was in step with the times. All over the U.S., aquatic creatures choked on human waste. Fish in the Great Lakes floated belly up by the thousands. The surface of the Cuyahoga River in Cleveland, smothered in oil from industrial discharges, burst into flame. Nothing so dramatic happened on Humboldt Bay. Instead, it was oysters that raised the alarm, like silent canaries in a subaquatic coal mine. In January 1973, a few months after Congress had passed the Clean Water Act, state inspectors found that oysters in the bay were contaminated with fecal coliform bacteria, microbes that thrive in human and animal feces. The entire bay was quarantined for months. Humboldt Bay had become California's oyster capital after the once-thriving San Francisco fishery died out in the early 1900s. The native oysters there were gone, suffocated in a big city deluge of raw sewage. Subjected to only a fraction of San Francisco Bay's human population, Humboldt's waters were relatively clean. The oyster farming industry got rolling in the 1950s, when some local entrepreneurs began to ship seed oysters in from Japan. The shellfish thrived in the fertile waters off Arcata and Eureka. Oyster farmers boating out to their underwater fields became an everyday part of life on the bay. Business boomed until the state inspectors shut it down that winter of 1973. Oysters spend their entire adult lives anchored to one spot and eat by pumping water through their guts, filtering out and digesting bits of algae, bacteria, and debris. Any microbe in the water will accumulate inside oysters. By the 1960s, scientists had begun to use them as living barometers of sewage pollution. Oysters were no longer just a popular delicacy on the half shell. They offered undeniable proof that Humboldt Bay, like so many other bodies of water, was tainted. On a gray afternoon in the spring of 1973, Robert Rasmussen stood at the doorway of the Ingomar Club, an ornate Victorian mansion so close to Humboldt Bay that he could hear the tide sloshing against a cement seawall. Bearded and rotund, Rasmussen resembled a youthful Santa Claus, but he was feeling tense rather than jolly. He loitered, examining the complicated curlicues of the building's wooden trim. He'd never been this close to it before. Didn't belong in this bastion of the county's most powerful men. Rasmussen, a botany professor moonlighting as an environmental consultant, had only been invited to lunch at the Ingomar because, as he explains it, the shit was hitting the proverbial fan. Waiting inside the Ingomar was a small knot of men in suits. The group centered around David Joseph, the director of the Regional Water Quality Control Board, a short, stocky man exuding an air of command. He'd helped to write clean water policies for the entire state of California, and he believed there was only one way to address the problems in Humboldt. Joseph wanted a high-tech, centralized treatment plant that would bypass the bay and discharge straight into the Pacific. All the sewage from Arcata and Eureka would have to be routed to one site, piped under the floor of the bay, treated, and released into the ocean. There'd be lots of expensive design and construction work involved. The engineers from Metcalf and Eddy, who sat with Joseph amid the polished oak and crystal of the club, were glad such a plum job had dropped into their laps. The men waiting for Rasmussen were expecting him to act as one more cog in the machinery the Clean Water Act of 1972 had set in motion. The legislation provided grant money to states for the construction of sewage treatment facilities, a lot of grant money. Confident that the feds would pick up much of the tab, Joseph and his colleagues had written a basin plan for the North Coast, an edict that forbade any discharge of sewage into the bay, treated or not. The cities of Eureka and Arcata had clubbed together to hire Metcalf and Eddy to design a new system for central Humboldt County so that they could comply with the basin plan. Metcalf and Eddy hired Bob Rasmussen's little firm, environmental research consultants, to write the environmental impact report, a newfangled document required by the recently passed California Environmental Quality Act. Rasmussen was the smallest fish in a vast bureaucratic pond. A heavy door swung open on well-oiled hinges, and Rasmussen was ushered into the Ingomar's high-ceilinged dining room. He sat across from Ron Roby, an influential young water attorney with California's State Water Resources Control Board. Years later, Rasmussen, having forgotten Roby's name, would inaccurately describe him as Joseph's sycophantic junior. "That whippersnapper told me this would be the easiest money I'd ever make," says Rasmussen. "All I had to do was follow the guidelines they'd already written, agree that a regional system was the only way to go." Rasmussen nodded at Roby and made vague affirmative noises. Then he went out and wrote a report that said the state strategy was all wrong. Humboldt Bay, he argued, had always been a natural sump. Every winter's rains washed nutrient-rich silt off the hills, into the creeks, and down to the bay. The muddy bay bottom grew a thick crop of eelgrass, the wide green blades swaying in unison, bending in the direction of the prevailing tide. The eelgrass sheltered an array of mollusks, worms, and young fish, and fed thousands of waterfowl that passed through on their long migrations. The plants, rooted in a deep black goo composed of their own decaying leaves, of dead salt marsh plants and algae and small water creatures, formed an important habitat, one worthy of protection. It was also, Rasmussen wrote, a habitat adapted to defecation and decay. The bay, he argued, was better suited to absorb treated sewage than the ocean. As long as the treatment process removed harmful bacteria, a bit of effluent should do no harm. Existing studies suggested that sewage did not constitute a significant addition to the rich stew of natural nutrients in Humboldt Bay. By contrast, sewage discharges to the open ocean, which were already standard procedure on the Southern California coast, had been shown to alter the ecology of the waters near outfall pipes. Algae bloomed. The number of marine species dwindled. Rasmussen's report was a long riff of criticism against the conventional approach to sewage pollution. Whether effluent was discharged to the bay or the ocean, dumping the stuff rather than recycling it would prove to be a temporary fix, not a long-term solution, he insisted. The idea that the temporary fix had to be ocean disposal was based on politics, not biology. Despite the 63 anonymous discharge pipes, the plants in Eureka leaking raw sewage, and the steady flow of dissolved cow manure, the only immediate problem in the bay was bacterial contamination. Yes, the communities at the water's fringe needed to clean up their act, treat their sewage, and disinfect it, but there was no reason, other than Joseph's edict, that they had to build a pipeline to carry their effluent beyond the bay. The engineers at Metcalf and Eddy were stunned when they read Rasmussen's report. He took the skeptical engineers out onto the bay and showed them the abundant growth of eelgrass rising out of the muck. He convinced them. The benefits of ocean discharge are illusory, the Metcalf and Eddy staff wrote in the documents they submitted to the cities of Arcata and Eureka. They recommended that Eureka build one high-capacity treatment plant that could handle all the city's sewage. Arcata's plant, which was already in good working condition, needed only a minor upgrade to ensure that the system did not overload during the heaviest rains. Both facilities, sited on the bay's edge, could release treated effluent right into its murky waters. This scenario made the most sense in terms of both the economy and ecology. The only potential obstacle was David Joseph and his crusade to forbid any wastewater at all from entering the bay. The Metcalf and Eddy report, with its subversive recommendation buried among pages of technical analysis, was presented to the Arcata City Council in March 1974. At the first meeting after Dan Hauser and Wesley Chesbro were elected. Months passed while the complexities of the sewer problem percolated in their brains. They had plenty of other problems to distract them. In April, Hauser, Chesbro, and Rudy Becking, an HSU forestry professor who also served on the city council, passed a resolution calling for an end to U.S. involvement in the Vietnam War. The members of the conservative contingent in town were outraged and never missed a chance to let the three responsible council members know it. Becking was a World War II veteran, survivor of a brutal Japanese POW camp. Well known as a straight talker with a powerful tendency to piss people off, he seemed impervious to criticism. Hauser and Chesbro, however, felt the sting of some very personal attacks. One night, after a meeting ended, Robin Arkley, the mill owner who'd papered the campus with posters admonishing students not to vote in the city council election, drew the two of them aside. In the midst of a heated conversation, Arkley flipped open his billfold, revealing a snapshot of Chesbro. "I carry this around," he announced, "so I can remember who to hate." Chesbro was juggling a complicated mixture of loyalties. He'd filed for conscientious objector status and was doing alternative service at the North Coast Environmental Center in Arcata. His environmentalist friends had serious doubts when he and Hauser began to talk about resisting the state's sewage plan. The Clean Water Act may not have been perfect, but for activists struggling to clean up polluted waters, it was the best opportunity to come along in years. Some influential environmentalists in town worried that if the city council fought the state, they'd lose that chance. In early September, after a city council meeting that had gone on past midnight, Chesbro, Hauser, and Alexandra Fairless, Arcata's first woman mayor, shared a few beers at the Jambalaya. The jam was a dim hangout just off the plaza, a two-block walk from City Hall. It was the bar favored by college students and others among the younger, longer-haired residents of town. When he wasn't doing research for the Environmental Center, Chesbro worked as the Jambalaya's bouncer. The three of them gathered around a rickety table, exhausted and wired. The meeting at City Hall had been full of intense debate. Council meetings in those days went on for a long time because of Alex, remembers Hauser. She enjoyed engaging people in argument and baiting her opponents. Arcata's city manager had just informed the council that fighting the state's sewage plan would be a mistake. The city would have to bring a legal challenge against Joseph's basin plan, and odds were high they'd lose. If they didn't jump on the state bandwagon now, they risked losing any shot at the federal money designated for sewage improvements under the Clean Water Act. Fairless wasn't strong on the technical details. When Hauser joined the council, she was happy to pass on to him the responsibility to represent Arcata in negotiations over the proposed regional sewage system. But she understood well enough that Joseph's grand vision of centralized treatment was flawed. The country was in the midst of an energy crisis. Long lines formed to get a few gallons of fuel at the local gas stations. A single sewage plant for the Humboldt Bay area would be the biggest energy consumer in the county. The pumps needed to move wastewater over the miles between Arcata and Eureka, and then across the bay to the open ocean, would suck down more power than the busiest lumber mill. In the late night dusk of the Jambalaya, the three friends hashed the issue over for the 100th time. The state refused to consider moving the proposed sewage pipeline in order to prevent development on the pastures that Hauser had worked so hard to preserve as open land. Joseph's plan looked to be a destructive waste of money and energy. Rasmussen, the resident expert, said all this was unnecessary. They could protect the bay in humbler, less damaging ways. It's hard to say exactly when the city council majority decided to fight despite the odds. Maybe the resolve came to each of them separately, on the quiet walk home from the jam, or in that peaceful instant before they opened their eyes and rolled out of bed the following morning. What is on the record is that at the next week's meeting, the council voted to direct the city attorney to determine whether Arcata would stand any chance at all in a legal battle with the state. They hired Rasmussen and his colleagues to try to poke more holes in David Joseph's arguments, hoping to sink them completely. Becking, fearless as usual, sided with the council's young radicals. "If the council has any guts at all," he said, "we should challenge the state." Part of the reason the city council resented the state's costly regional sewage plan was that Arcata had already sunk serious money into upgrading its treatment plant. In its 50 acres of newly built oxidation ponds, microbes broke down organic matter, while winds off the bay helped to keep the water oxygenated. The ponds attracted hundreds of ducks. Arcata's treatment plant was the most popular birding spot in the area and served the same function as the conventional high-tech activated sludge treatment systems preferred by the regional board. The city was carrying over $1 million in bond debt incurred in building the oxidation ponds, and installing a chlorination system to disinfect effluent. If forced to join the regional system, Arcata would have to pay millions for its construction and maintenance, while continuing to pay off its investment in a local treatment plant rendered useless. Instead, Arcata hoped to improve its existing plant while finding a way to recycle the treated wastewater. A fisheries professor from HSU had been experimenting with raising young salmon and steelhead in treated sewage effluent. The city council hoped the intense use of its oxidation ponds by migrating birds, along with the recycling of effluent in aquaculture, could justify an exemption from the regional project. Fairless asked state officials to meet with Arcata's city council to discuss alternatives to the regional sewage system. David Joseph attended, along with Roby. "We hoped we could develop more advanced biological treatment here in town," remembers Fairless. "David Joseph asked what my degree was in, and I told him I was a home ec major." Decades later, the memory of Joseph's response still makes her bristle. "When you get your degree in biology," he said, "I'll be glad to discuss this issue with you." Joseph and his engineer at the regional board, John Hannum, had both helped shape statewide regulations. They were passionate supporters of a rule called the Bays and Estuaries Policy, enacted in May 1974, which banned all discharges of sewage to California bays unless the effluent could be shown to enhance the waters. San Francisco Bay, though badly polluted, was exempted from the rule, officially because of its high tidal exchange and the depths of its waters. However, those familiar with the political workings of the time suggest the true reason was that a discharge ban was not remotely possible in such a large, urbanized estuary. "Humboldt Bay does not need anything your waste plant can discharge," Joseph told the city council, "including distilled water. If Arcata found a way to meet state water quality standards without joining the regional system, he pledged to have the standards changed to force them into line." Hauser explained his struggle to keep open space between the cities of Arcata and Eureka. Running a sewage line through the miles of pasture land between the two cities would guarantee the kind of urban sprawl he'd uprooted his family to escape. "The Emperor Joseph sat and listened to my passionate plea," Hauser says, "and he said, 'You can't win.' It was clear that going against him would mean a big fight." Joseph had grown up on the Southern California coast. He witnessed the devastation of marine life, choked by pollution from sprawling cities. He had a passion for righting that wrong. His strategy, however, did not take Humboldt's local conditions into account. The small cities scattered at Humboldt Bay's edge were home to only 40,000 people. Timber and fisheries, and to some extent, the new industry of illegal backwoods marijuana farming, drove the local economy. The bay was alive, hosting rays, halibut, harbor seals, and a commercial oyster industry that provided two-thirds of the oysters harvested in California. Bob Rasmussen, the marine botanist who'd been among the first to oppose the regional plant, wrote a scathing critique of the state's plan. He pointed out that recent studies by the State Department of Public Health found no significant bacterial contamination from local sewage plants. Runoff from cattle pastures was the major source of the coliform bacteria sometimes found in bay oysters, a problem that the regional sewage system would do nothing to address. He questioned the supposed economies of a large-scale project. The same kind of facility had been dismissed as far too expensive in the Metcalf and Eddy report only a few months earlier. Arthur Einerfeld, an engineer with Metcalf and Eddy, had said that locating a regional treatment plant on the Samoa Peninsula as the regional board recommended, would court disaster by pumping raw sewage under the bay floor. A pipe failure could make the dire predictions of bay pollution a reality in minutes. The authors of the Basin Plan claimed that without an ocean discharge, Humboldt Bay waters would soon become oxygen depleted, making the bay unlivable for fish. They forecast that the bay would experience a deadly syndrome, known to aquatic ecologists as eutrophication. A heavy load of nutrients from sewage would cause a dense algal bloom. Masses of algae would die off and sink to the bottom, where the bacteria decomposing their remains would use up all the oxygen in the water. The result would be an underwater dead zone where no aquatic creatures could survive. Eutrophication had been well documented in Chesapeake Bay, Long Island Sound, and other polluted estuaries on the East Coast. But in forecasting the fate of Humboldt Bay, the plan quoted data that seemed to be lifted from a report on the much more urbanized and polluted San Francisco Bay. Very little information on the water quality or ecology of Humboldt Bay existed, and what there was came from studies by Rasmussen and his HSU colleagues. They'd found communities of bottom-dwelling creatures, plankton, and marine plants consistent with a healthy ecosystem. The bay, Rasmussen argued, was using the nutrients in sewage, which served as a replacement for a vast acreage of vanished salt marsh that once would have enriched the waters with decomposing plants and the feces of hundreds of thousands of waterfowl. The same effluent that nurtured the bay would act as a destructive shock to marine life in the open ocean off the Samoa Peninsula, which was not adapted to high nutrient loads. Milt Boyd, a marine ecologist at HSU, who testified against the proposed regional sewage system, agreed. Looking back, Boyd acknowledges that the HSU scientists of the 1970s had very little evidence for their position. Years later, they would learn that the dominant cord grass in surviving Humboldt marshes was in truth an exotic species, introduced in ballast water from ships that sailed between South America and Arcata in the late 1800s. Later studies would show that healthy salt marsh does act as a nutrient sink during spring and summer when native plants are growing. Plants die back in the fall, and winter rains wash their remains into the bay where they become a nutrient source. People on both sides of the argument were describing Humboldt Bay in terms of their own fears and visions. The 1970s was an era when you could say almost...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.